today we are at Noble Rey Brewing. We just talked to these guys just Big Texas a couple weeks ago, but we decided it was time for a follow-up 2 weeks later.
We were surprisingly sober this time.
Yeah, unlike usual.
Yeah,
we're working on it.
Yeah, we're trying to change that right now. So we're here with Chris and Kindra, Rigoult.
Hello.
Is that right? And Tommy Miller, the head brewer.
Yeah.
Chris, your official title is El Jefe, the boss.
Yeah, that wasn't my official title that I gave myself. That was just kind of what showed up on a business card. And we ran with it. So, yeah, I am the boss, though, even though the two people flanking me probably make more of the decisions than I do. Or at least I divert to them on decision-making.
So. Kindra, what's your official title?
Give me the mic. Marketing support.
What does that mean exactly?
Well, I have a full-time job, so I don't work here full-time, eventually I will. I just help with marketing, help with tap room, front of house stuff. So,
what do you do when you're not working here?
Digital advertising.
Oh, okay. Nice.
So, yeah.
Nice.
It works.
And I assume the two of you are full-time.
Yeah.
More than full-time. Yeah.
So, I just want to go back and tell me about the start of Noble Rey. You guys started in 2012, you said?
Yeah. So, no, we founded in 2012, with kind of a dream and the ideology of just trying to be like, yeah, we'll open up a brewery. How hard can it be? I mean, because I was naive and stupid. And, you know, like a lot of people, whenever they think of breweries, they kind of say, you know, like, how hard can it be? You know, like, I can do it in my garage. It must be super simple.
It sounds like the very custom drunk conversation people have that say, let's just open a bar.
Yeah. Oh, no, it was definitely that. I mean, I worked, I did, like, logistics, banking, and, like, insurance and stuff before all of this. And I just got tired of being a number. And so what happened was, well, what's your passion? Like, what do you want to do with your life? And I've always had a passion for alcohol. I was a winemaker out of college.
Nice.
That was my first job, was to make wine, because it was either that or go into real estate. And then thankfully I went into wine because it was like the market crashed like that year.
Oh,
so
yeah.
If I had gone into real estate, then I would have been bankrupt at like 23.
Wow.
So, we kind of came up with the idea is stop being a number and, you know, find your own path, you know, create your own character. Kind of thing. That's a good slogan. We should do that. Yeah, we should do that. Why have we not done that?
Especially given the
Be Noble, Drink Noble. Screw that.
Yeah. Create your own character kind of reminds me, as I've said before, you guys have my favorite cans in the business.
Oh, thank
you. The artwork is awesome. Kind of reminds me.
You're talking about the actual cans, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
What a make it
awkward. That's what I do best. That's my personal slogan.
So what was the breaking moment in your career when you were working in finance that you were just want to rage flip everything? And
everybody here mostly knows the story, is that my mom got a blood clot. Mm. And I was being considered such a number that whenever I got the call that she was in the hospital, like, I was like, all right, got to go, you know, family first. They didn't believe me. I needed a doctor's note from, like, the ER stating that my mom was actually in the hospital near death. And I showed up, like, 15 minutes late the next day, and they were like, yeah, it's going to come out of your PTO. And so I I went home, you know, kind of angry.
Yeah.
And I think by the end of the week, I walked in and said, you know, you guys, like, I'm out.
Yeah.
And after that, I started working at places like Luck, Growler bars. I applied to be at Deep Ellum, was the runner up for one of the sales guys' jobs. And we kind of joke about that, you know, how, like, if I had been like the finalist, maybe, like, you know, how different the craft beer scene would be, because I'm a different kind of guy, I guess. But yeah, but Tommy and I would have met sooner, because Tommy came from Deep Ellum. He was one of the sales guys at Deep Ellum.
Really?
So he and I could have, you know, argued a lot sooner in life.
So tell me about, like, what's the romance here between you and Tommy? How did you guys I want to know what Tommy did before brewing also, but how did you guys meet? And
it was kind of like Romancing the Stone. I mean, have you that classic 80s movie. We're being chased by Danny DeVito through the jungle.
That's a really weird story. Yeah,
yeah, he wrote romance novels. It was crazy. I was an Indiana Jones ripoff. So, I don't know. Here, I'll let Tommy explain, like, where he kind of came into the scene and how we met, because, yeah, he tells it better.
So I was in the Air Force, kind of when I got into craft beer altogether. I was stationed overseas in Tokyo, and then After that, I went traveling, met my wife in Ibiza, Spain, which prompted me to move to England. And so living in England, I really fell in love with different kinds of beer. Her family owns a 15th century pub.
Wow.
That's really cool. Into more beers. Mm-hmm. The big beer bar, they have about 12 cask pumps. And so just fell in love with the whole industry there, really, and planned on staying there. But we almost bought our own pub. That fell through. And one day we said, fuck it, let's move to Dallas. That's where I'm from. I wanted to come home. And the first weekend I was here, I met John Reardon, Zach Vicky, all the guys at Deep Ellum. They were just starting up, and they're like, come on board, man. And I jumped on board and, you know, worked under Drew Herter. He's now a brain dead, and delivered to sales, to helping out in the back. I just got to learn the whole industry from the ground up with a startup brewery that, you know, it's very successful, which is great. And then from there, I went to Lakewood. Before I even got the job at Lakewood, I'd met Chris, and he told me about, you know, starting Noble Rey. I thought it was an awesome idea. He asked me if I wanted to come on board. So, so when I got the job at Lakewood, you know, it was pretty, I told him up front, like, of this other opportunity. Didn't really want to talk about it. But then when Noble Rey started getting along, I came over full time about almost a year before we actually opened this place. And which is great, because, you know, I really love doing the startup thing with Deep Ellum, and from the ground up, and seeing all the mistakes and the stuff that breaks and knowing how to fix it. Drew knows how to fix anything, so kind of being under his wing just taught me on the fly, and it really helped us here starting and not, you know, necessarily having the financial abilities as a lot of breweries, where they just come in with, you know, millions of dollars. We pretty much built this whole place, you know, shoestring from the ground up. We tiled the bathrooms, put in the floors, you know, built this tap room, everything.
It's almost, it could almost be, it's like its own HGTV show. It's like, yeah. Building a brewery.
It should have been, yeah. It should have been, for sure.
It should have been a reality.
Yeah, yeah. But then they would see, like, what the bars look like without the stuff hiding everything inside. So, yeah, it may not have been the greatest craftsmanship, but just to put in the tanks in the back and everything, I mean, been here from day one, and I love it. So I love it. Yeah.
That's cool. So do you force your in-laws to carry your beer over in Spain?
In England,
I'm sorry, the pub?
They want to really bad, possibly in the future.
Yeah.
We're working on that. So my father-in-law, he recently passed away, but before that, that's pretty much at every brewery I've worked at, it's always said, like, when can I get your beer? I want to put your beer on here. We want to be the place in England to carry it, so... Yeah, hopefully one day we'll make that happen.
Well, this is a little off topic, but kind of on the topic of that. Are they having any issues over there with the corporations coming in trying to buy all the pubs and everything in England?
That's a huge
pressure?
It's a huge issue, and that's one of the things that made my in-law's pub so successful, is they stood up to it, and they're like, we're not selling out. They're one of the only independent pubs around, and with probably in about a 50-mile radius. They're one of the handful of independent ones, and they're – to have extreme loyal customers because of that. They make their own decisions. They choose what beers they want to bring in. And my father-in-law was a real stickler for searching out the best beers in Germany to bring in. If they're going to have German beers, the best beers from around, and that's a good thing that their pub gets to do.
That's cool. I know it's an increasingly rare thing over in England to be independent.
Bateman's is taking over.
Yeah. So, Chris and Kindra, I know you guys are obviously married. So tell us about your love story. How you met?
Yeah, he doesn't like hearing the sappy bullshit. So our story.
I met Chris at a kickball league. Super nerdy, but that's how we met. And he just came home. Like, we were dating for like 3 or 4 years, and he pretty much came home extremely miserable. And I said, what the heck do you want to do with your life? Because I'm not going to stick around for you being miserable for forever.
Yeah.
So, unfortunately, I gave him...
Still dating.
Yeah. And he's like, well, I think I want to open a brewery. And I was like, let's do it. Now's the time.
Yeah.
So, that's what we decided to do. And, you know, it took us 3-4 years to open. And we went through every single hurdle imaginable.
I imagine.
But we're here, and we're extremely proud of it. So that's kind of our love story.
Ooh, I mean, yeah, so the love story actually was, like, I formed the brewery before I even, like, asked her to marry me.
Yeah.
And so it was one of those things, like, after going through, like, 6 months of trying to, like, get everything up and running, I finally, like, went to my dad because I'd put all my money into the brewery and was like, hey, I want to ask Kindra to marry me, but can you spot me some money? And the answer was, it's about time. And he was like, of course. And so, like, we literally went, like, to, like, the jewelry store, like straight away.
Yeah.
And so it was like, he was like, all right, what about that one? What about that one? And so she didn't know about it, and it burned a hole in my pocket for about a month because I was dumb and didn't plan stuff out. But yeah, I mean, and then after that, like, it was kind of one of those things where she helped me pass my yeast exam because I went to brewing school. So it was one of those things, I understood everything else. I can technically do stuff. Like, if I'm in front of the brew house and I know what I'm doing,
yeah,
you put a piece of paper in front of me and tell somebody how to do it. Blank. Nothing. I'm like, it's kind of, you should know how to do that. Just, yeah, you eyeball it or you do this. I mean, I don't eyeball it, but yeah. So, no, the love story started there. So she was with me whenever I tried to be, when I applied at Deep Ellum, when I worked at Petacolis, and whenever I worked over at Lakewood. And when I work, I mean, I was their intern. Right. So brewing school, man, ain't it grand? So
how is it? I mean, you don't work here all the time, but how is it? Like, I work in my wife and I both work from the same office at home, so okay. But luckily she's out in the field most of the time. How is it working every day with your spouse, or a lot of days with your spouse? Like,
oh, she wanted to take that real quick.
Well, I mean, when you open a business or when you run a business, it's you live it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not, there's never really, like, downtime, I guess.
Yeah.
I mean, you get that from time to time, but, I mean, we just, I think the most important part for us, working together, and especially when I come on full time, is really just taking time for ourselves, you know, and, like, scheduling time to do a date night or, like, you know.
It's almost like having kids.
Yeah, exactly. So, do you have any comments on this?
Say, yeah, it's like, it's kind of like having kids. It's like, yeah, as soon as all of our employees are like our kids.
Yeah.
It's like, sometimes, like, you know, it's kind of like having adult kids, but, you know, sometimes you love them, and sometimes you just kind of look at them and go, really?
And they take all your money, really? Just like kids.
Yeah. Oh, no, for real, yeah.
You just don't have to change their diapers.
Yeah. Oh, do we need to tell that story? Just kidding. There is no story yet. I'm sure there will be soon. But, yeah, no, it's not hard. I don't think it's that hard working with a spouse. We've kind of just realized what, like, who does what and who's going to run what. I mean, I already know that she's my boss, so that's...
So her card should say El Jefe, then.
Her card should say El Jefe, and mine will just say, like, that guy. So that dude that does some stuff, so...
So were you guys homebrewers before you started? Now, you did obviously the winemaking.
Yeah, well, I was a homebrewer. I started at, like, 13.
Wow.
With my dad.
Got it early.
Yeah, well, he tried to do the whole discouraging thing, where he was a homebrewer. He made, like, an IPA. He thought it had, like, an off flavor and was just like, hey, man, try this out.
Yeah.
Like, thought that it would be too bitter for me and I wouldn't like it. And the thing is that he turned his back and I downed that thing. It was gone. He turned back around. I was like, where'd the beer go? And I was like, I spilt it. Yeah. I don't know.
Into my mouth.
And he was like, did you drink all of that? And I was like, yeah, man, I really enjoyed it. I was like, that was really good. What made it taste like that? And he was like, well, those were the hops. And so, like, 13, I'm getting this education on, well, what do the hop do, like, second edition, third edition, stuff like that, just where it's like, oh, my God, I didn't know this. And it's one of those things, if he had explained it to me a little better, I probably would have paid more attention in science and stuff. Just been like, oh, wait, this is what I need to know? Cool. But, no, I was, like, I was his lackey. I got to clean everything, and I was his cellarman, you know.
Yeah.
Hey, clean this. Cool. No, you don't get to do anything cool. You don't get to drink it either. And then, you know, I was just a snob throughout high school. I didn't go to, like, the kegger parties and stuff. I just was hanging out with my dad, drinking. By that time, I think we'd graduated to, like, bourbon and stuff, though. So, not making it, but drinking it. So,
bathtub bourbon.
Yeah. I don't know if that'd be good at all.
So, your dad's part of the business, too, right?
Yes. Yeah, he's actually in the office right now looking at numbers, mumbling, and getting really complacent. So
he controls all the money?
He does.
Mr. Moneybags.
Yeah. I call him Daddy Warbucks, so...
So, Tommy, were you a home brewer before you officially got into it?
I started home brewing while I was stationed in Japan. There's some guys who are home brewers there, and they kind of started teaching me. They're pretty advanced, so they're doing like open fermentation stuff like back in 2003. Mm-hmm. And wow. Over there, a lot of people brew on like sake setups. A lot of the brew over there is made in a sake facility, so they're all into open fermentation, doing crazy stuff. And that's kind of how I got started home brewing. And yeah, from there, just each country I went to, tried different beers, got come home, try to make those beers, and that's kind of got it into it. And then when we finally moved to Dallas, I just constantly homebrew, trying to improve recipe building, and that's when I started reading a lot of books and stuff like that.
Question about the facility too. What made you guys go with a brew pub over just a regular brewery? Just, you know, like other ones around here, Peticolis, Bayou, and many of them in the area.
No, I mean, it's funny. When all the laws changed back in 2013, like I was, like in 2012, I was just going to be a production brewery. Laws changed in 2013, which I had just officially joined the guild and was literally just thrown into like those meetings. They're like, hey, do you want to go down to Austin and talk? I was like, sure, I guess. And just remember being like, I'm way in over my head. But what I took away from it was, you know, the brew pubs kind of got a little bit more, they got a lot more out of the deal back in 2013. I feel like it was, you know, their barrelage got moved up. They could sell product on site for off site consumption, and that, you know, they could self distribute up to 1500 barrels. And at the time I was thinking kind of on the same level as Peticolis, which is I'm only going to do 1500 to 2000 barrels first year or even second year. Like, we're going to, you know, it's going to be just like Peticolis. And then the market blew up, and nothing's like Peticolis. Like, I mean, that is, like, that's the gold standard for, you know, like, what you could wish for as a brewery. And so as I saw kind of, like, the market changing, it was, okay, I want to be able to can or bottle my beer, and I want people to be easily accessible to it. This just made more sense. It was funny because I had a couple other brewery owners that was like, hey, man, you need to do the brew pub thing. And me being me, I was like, man, fuck you guys. Don't tell me what to do. I'm going to do whatever I want to do. And then like 6 months later, I was like, I should probably do a brew pub thing, huh? And they're like, yeah, that's what we've been saying, dude, you dumbass. So it takes me a while to like learn things from other people, but I'm a little bit more open and receptive now. Especially since Tommy was like, hey, we should do sours. And I was like, I don't want to do sours. He's like, no, but we're going to do sours. And so now we do sours, and it's totally awesome because, yeah, these are my two sour drinkers are Tommy and Kindra. I was late to the game on that.
I am too. I'm slowly coming around on it.
And now I'm obsessed with it. Like, I mean, we were in Brussels 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago, last month. Anyways, doesn't matter when it was. We were there, like we were all three there, and we all went to Cancion, and it was one of those things where you go to like the birthplace of sours and get to hang out. And I was like, well, this is how you should have your experience. Like, this is how all sour breweries should be. But you know, nobody's gonna be like 120 years old and still kicking ass. So
tell me about the challenges of, aside from having to construct your own facility, tell me about the challenges of starting your own brew pub. I mean, there's got to be a lot of lessons you learned.
Do we have like a full day to go over that?
Maybe some
general
highlights.
Contractors lie. the banks are only in it for themselves. Those are just the highlights. No, I mean, we learned a lot of lessons where it was, you know, be careful who you trust. Mm. Always raise more capital than you think you're going to need.
I've always heard the rule is whatever your number is, double it.
Oh, no. For us, it was whatever the number is, triple it, quadruple it, whatever. Because I was under the impression, I think we were like, when our initial funding was like just under $1 million, and I was like, oh, cool, that'll, like, we can knock out a seriously badass brewery with that. Well, I mean, as the market changes and inflation and all that crap, you're like, all right, cool, we need more money. And so, like, you know, we opened up a second tap room. Well, that costs like about $100,000. Yeah, we want to expand this tap room. Now that's another like $20,000. Stuff like that. It's one of those things where like the things that the unforeseen, mm-hmm. like you never know what's going to happen. Like we thought a 15 barrel system would last us like 3 years, 3 to 4 years. We're already looking at like either changing that out or adding a couple vessels to it. We thought the five 30 barrel tanks that we started off with would get us through the first 4 years, and we just added three 60 barrel tanks. So and we're a year and a half in. Yeah. It's a great problem to have, but, I mean, year and a half into actual production, and we've already, like, just doubled our capacity.
Do you feel forced to expand, or is that something you want
to do? It's something that we want to do. I'll be honest, like, whenever I started, I wanted to keep things small. I always thought I just want to be, like, something local. And then our marketing just kind of took us in a different direction. And so one of the things that I would give as advice is always be open to like what you like, what the market says, and like kind of where, like, you know, the universe directs you.
I think also too, it's becoming a very much for the newer breweries that are opening, like us, is an expand or die type situation where we're not constantly keeping beer on the market in all the stores and your presence very known, then you start losing shelf space, you start losing taps, and someone with a bigger system or more money is going to go out there and start taking those taps.
Yeah.
It's like what he said, the pedicolas thing, you just can't do it anymore, where you don't really have sales. People are just calling you and want your beer, and they can hold that line where they are, where if we just produced what we are or what we have been and stop trying to push upwards, you lose accounts, you lose.
We'd be gone in like next year.
We don't have a five-year name to lay back on.
Because it felt like you guys, I mean, I saw you on taps, and then just all of a sudden your cans were everywhere.
Yeah.
It was like an explosion of, you know.
Yeah. We'd love to see our taps more, though.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, like, yeah, I think it's funny, that's our big focus now, is that, like, our cans were, like, that is the one thing that we can kind of just go, all right, cool, our cans sell themselves.
Right.
Not to be, like, arrogant about it, but it's, like, the design, people want to come back to it, and the beer that's in it is good, people come back to it. Thing is that for us, now our focus is draft. More or less, it's not going to be all draft. It's just going to be, you know, balancing of the two. It's a nice balancing act. Yeah, trying to get, like, I think we're like 70 or 80% can, like, is our production right now, which is great.
Yeah.
But I'd love the margins on the draft.
Well, so hard. I mean, from what I understand, it's hard to find tap space around here.
Oh, no, it's for sure. I mean, especially with, it's going to sound like I'm going to shit on out of state breweries, but with out of state breweries coming into this market, people are like, oh, we want to get, you know, this beer, we want to get that beer. And the thing is, I always say is I love going to different cities and states and countries and stuff because I want to try what's local there. Mm. I don't want to try something where it's like, cool, like I could have gone to, let's say, Arizona, because if I said the other state that I was thinking, everybody knows what I was talking about. But like, say like a brewery from Arizona that's blown up, they come in here, people are just going ape shit over it. Sometimes you're just like, cool, that beer tastes just like a beer down the street, but you guys didn't give it a chance. You're just following the trend, you're following like the name.
Right.
And that's great for that brewery to have that name behind it. But a lot of times it's like the people in your own backyard, it's like you should probably give them a shot first. It's like the restaurants, you know, like whenever you read those articles, like this restaurant's going out of business, you're like, oh man, I would have loved to have gone there. Well, why didn't you? You should have gone and checked it out while it was open.
Well, why did you go to Chili's 10 times?
Yeah, it's like, I saw, hey, man, you went to Taco Cabana like 5 times last week. You could have gone to that one, like, taqueria at least once.
Yeah.
So
where does the name Noble Rey come from?
It's an anagram from our dog's name, Harley. We pulled out Ray, but Hal Ray sounds really stupid. But, you know, Ray is Spanish for king. It's a musical note. So we got really drunk one night. I think it was like a bottle or two of Jameson, a couple six packs, and then
that's a full night.
Yeah, back in 2012 when we partied a little harder.
Yeah.
No, it was just somebody like yelled out like at the end of the night, and they're like, "Hey," because I used to be a missionary and like, and I would go to like other countries and just build like houses and stuff. They're like, "Hey, man, you've done like some noble stuff. What do you call it? Like Noble Rey? Like get it? Like a noble king." And I was like, yeah, no, I get it. And I just remember waking up, like, with a massive hangover the next day and, like, looking at Kindra going, did we come up with a name for a brewery? Because I feel like Noble Rey sounds awesome.
Yeah.
And she's like, let's think about it for another couple of days. And I think it was, like, 4 days later I filed the LLC.
Nice.
So
it definitely stands out. It's definitely a very standout name.
Well, one of the reasons why we were trying to open in Grapevine for the longest time, and I mean, there's Grapevine Craft Brewery, and that's great. But the thing is, that a name like that, like, locks you to a certain place.
Yeah.
Like, Pedicolas, that's his name. But he could literally take that anywhere.
Right.
So we wanted a brewery name that you could literally take anywhere.
Yeah.
Like, it doesn't mean that we're not Dallas-Fort Worth brewery people, but it just means, like,
if you had to move, you could.
Yeah, like, if we had to move, like, hey, for whatever reason, like, we're going to open up a brewery in Portland.
Yeah.
But Maine. I was talking about Maine. I'm just kidding.
But Lakewood and Deep Ellum, however, would have a hard time.
Well, Deep Ellum, the thing is, that, like, I mean, Deep Ellum you only know that if you're from Dallas.
That's probably, yeah. That's
and Lakewood,
true.
Too. I mean, there's a Lakewood, Colorado.
Yeah.
So, but, like, city names, you're kind of like, hey, we're Dallas Brewing Company.
Yeah.
They'd be like, I wonder, are they talking about Dallas, Oregon, or Dallas, Texas?
Yeah.
So.
So you guys were kind of, I guess, the third wave of breweries around here.
Yeah.
Because I guess it was Raw and Franconia were kind of the first wave.
Yep.
And then Pedicles, Deep Ellum were second wave. Yeah. You guys were kind of third wave.
I would actually say we were more fourth wave.
Really, were you? Okay.
Yeah, but the thing is that since we got that early start with putting our name out there, people do associate us with the third wave with, like, Martin House and
say, it seems like
all
I've
those guys.
Seen, like, you at Big Texas or Untappd forever.
Yeah.
So.
That's what we wanted you to think. No, no, it's one of those things where people think that we've been open for, like, 2 or 3 years, mm-hmm. but we've only, like, we're about to, like, this October, we're celebrating our second anniversary.
Yeah.
So it's one of those things where, you know, we try to market like we've been here for a while.
Yeah.
Mostly because Tommy's got the experience. He's been around from, it's like, you know, the second wave began, because there was, like, a 9-year gap between, like, RAR opening and then literally anything else other than Franconia.
Right.
So it's one of those things where, you know, we've been established, like, we've been a part of the scene. So I think that's where a lot of people kind of get that feel from is the, oh, I feel like I've seen you everywhere. It's like, well, we used to sponsor Brew Riot, like, when it was, like, 4 years ago.
Okay.
But we didn't have a brewery then.
Yeah.
We were just
getting our name out there.
Yeah, we're just trying to get our name out there and give them beer for free.
Yeah.
So.
So how do you, and being part of that, so I guess we're on our sixth wave then of breweries coming down the pipe. We've got so many new guys coming out.
Mm-hmm.
How hard is it to stand out? In this market, given that you were kind of, I guess now you're kind of in the middle wave.
Yeah.
Do you have a hard time standing out?
Like we were talking about, like, cans and stuff. No, but draft wise, I mean, it's one of those things where, like, if you have a slow moving beer, like, there could be, like, an account that's just like, oh, their beer doesn't move. Well, it's like, it could have just been that beer. It could have been that time of the month, like, time of the year. I don't say that time of the month. That sounds awkward. But no, or it could be that time of the month. It could be, like, it was a hot day, and you've got, like a stout out. Because, I mean, it's Texas. I mean, it could be February, and it could be, like, 90 degrees.
Right.
So if you've got an Imperial stout out, and it's on out an account, and they're like, oh, that beer didn't move. Yeah, well, it was spring weather in the middle of winter. Like, so, and that's the hard thing to do, engage in, like, in this market is what beer is going to move. I mean, Temptress, that's a stout that moves year round.
Right.
But I mean, they made it taste the way it needs to. And that's why you don't see a whole lot of people going after, like, the stout game. Is there's, like, same thing with, like, Velvet Hammer and stuff. Nobody's really going to be like, hey, let's do an Imperial Red Ale. Mm. So it's just kind of finding, like, what that next thing is that you can hang your hat on, like a Lakewood or a Pedicolas or, like, the Deep Ellum Blonde or, you know, stuff like that, where, like, people are going to go, oh, sweet, I associate that beer with that brewery, and that's all, like, all we really want. I think we've kind of figured that out. We've got, like, 1A and 1B. Just, yeah, we've got Sex in a Canoe, which is American Light Lager, and then the Vertigo, which is the Double IPA. And if we could keep those in stock the way we want to, I mean, we would only have tanks with those beers in them.
Yeah,
so.
We sold out of our last batch of Vertigo in 3 hours, and the next day our distributor called me and was like, hey man, when you got more? And I was like, I haven't even brewed it yet. No, we just emptied our tank. That's kind of our home run hitter right now, but it's with all the other breweries coming into the state and having such a big PR push behind it, all the bars, of course, are, because people are coming in and going to ask for those beers, and they're not really asking for Noble Rey. Maybe they see us as being, you know, well, we could get Noble Rey anytime, but we can't get these beers. These are new, and they don't, they almost like they're limited, but they're coming into the state to stay.
So they'll be in the cans in the stores later on.
And a lot of our beers are, it's hard to get that, you know, stamp, this is Noble Rey. And a lot of people don't even realize, like, all the beers that we brew. We brew a lot of different beers throughout the year.
Like,
and,
7 or 8.
Yeah, the yearly beer. So it's hard to put a stamp on these are Noble Rey beers, you know, because a lot of people just don't know. We don't have that huge PR budget to put out and be like, you got to have this beer, you got to have this. So it's hard for bars to keep on. I understand that, but I think eventually we'll have a home run hitter that will really start getting us taps.
Yeah, and I was going to ask, are you guys still, you're not self-distributing now, right? You guys working with the your distributor, right?
No, we've never been self-distributed, actually. Okay. I think our first ever keg was sold by, like, it was in August of 2015, and it was sold by Full Clip Craft Distributors to the bottle shop. Yeah, it was the bottle shop on Lower Greenville.
Right, the one that just went out of business.
RIP. Yep. But, hey, we bought, actually, their coolers. So, like, our can display coolers are all of their can display coolers. So, that's how we, let the dream live on. So,
now, do you say you have 80% sales seem to be coming from the cans? With all of these new breweries coming in from all the states, are you guys actually actively, are you hearing any feedback about having to fight for shelf space? Or since you're having so much success there and they sell, you guys are just in at this point?
So it's funny, actually, we don't have any issues with the shelf space other than keeping up with demand.
Like, that's a nice problem to have, for sure.
If we could keep up with the demand, we would have, like, you know, four or five SKUs across the board. But a lot of times it's like, you know, we had like a hot liquor tank implode in like end of December. So that pretty much shut our brewery down for a month. Oh, so man. That was fun. And so now we're still playing catch up. Like, it's real fun whenever, like, we come in and look at the board, or I say we, I mean, Tommy looks at the board and is like, well, I've got like five double brews this week just to get caught up.
Was there any thought of contracting out to somebody to get it to make up for volume?
Thing is that Texas state laws don't allow us to contract brew in the state of Texas with a contract brewery.
I thought I heard when Grapevine retracted and decided to become just a brew pub.
Yeah, they do contract.
So why can't?
Because they're a Texas brewery, and we're a Texas Texas brew pub.
So you can't contract.
So, well, I'm looking into things. So
that's annoying. I've got
a few ideas, and I mean, I'll toot my own horn, but it's like, if I put my mind to something, I generally find out how to make it work. Yeah, I find loopholes. So, and so if TABC is watching. You wrote the rules, man. I'm just playing.
I guess you probably learned a lot from Michael Petticoles on that front.
I did. Yeah. Well, I mean, I'll say, like, the one time that I ever got, like, an attaboy from Michael Petticoles was whenever we opened our second tap room. Mm-hmm. Nobody thought it was ever going to be possible that, a Texas brewery could have a standalone tap room. Because now that just kind of sets everybody up for, here's the game plan of how to do it.
Yeah.
And I remember he called and was like, hey, you can't do that. Like, that's, like, it's illegal. And I was like, well, talked to TABC and I talked to so-and-so and they said it was cool, and he's like, oh, here, let me call the guild right quick. And he calls back like 30 minutes later and he's like, well, our guild attorney just wanted to say, like, way to go, man. Like, it's like you kind of set, like, the platform for, like, everybody to, like, how to do it. And I've talked to other brew pubs and other breweries that, you know, their production is at such a limit where they, like, okay, cool, we're never gonna make more than 10,000 barrels. Mm-hmm. Let's just become a brew pub. How does that work? And so, like, I'll, you know, get, like, some random email and just say, like, this is how you file your paperwork. And literally it's just like, this is just how you set up your filing, and then after that you're golden. And I can't take all the credit for that. I think it's one of the things where we backed into, like, their filing. Like, it's one of the things where TABC was just like, oh, we filed you like this, and it just so happened that was
how it worked out.
I don't understand if you're under 10,000 why you wouldn't have a brew pub license. Just being able to sell as much beer as we sell out of our tap rooms, insane in package.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We have a hard time keeping up with the package just in our own tap room.
Yeah.
And as a brew pub, the only way for you to expand your distribution is by opening up other tap rooms.
Second location, yeah. Which we've looked into doing as well. But that's like, we're a year and a half in, so that's like the 5-year goal is to have like a second location.
Right.
But there is a potential that we'll be maxed out capacity by the end of 2018 for this space. Mm-hmm. So if we do that, then it becomes like a real hard and needed conversation with, like, not just our bankers and investors, but you know, with our staff is like, can we operate a second location? That is a production facility. So, but we got ideas for that too. So, like,
Oh, I was gonna say, do you ever have any thoughts of just converting to a full-on brewery and getting rid of the brew pub concept?
Not right now.
Yeah, not anytime soon.
Not anytime soon. It just depends on how the legislation laws go. And right now, it's like every other year you do legislation, or so we got a lot of stuff in 2013. Didn't get a whole lot in 2015. Looks like I don't think a whole lot's going to change much in 2017, but if they added, like, you could do, like, off-premise sales, that would be like something that we would look into.
Deep Ellum gets their way and gets the laws that they're fighting for passed, which John Rudin is very good at, seems to be good at getting stuff like that done. If he, I mean, it would be, we'd be able to do it. I think with us, we, we're just a little bit different in the, like, our small batch system is starting. We do a lot more funkier, weird stuff, and we're going to start doing really crazy stuff on our 3.5-barrel system that we just bought. And being able to sell that package out of our tap room, that not only brings a huge crowd on Saturdays, but it'll bring a crowd through the week and sell a lot of package as well as pints out of our tap room. So it doesn't really make sense for us to go to any other model.
Right.
It would just limit of how we want to brew and how we want to operate if we were to go that way.
Yeah, they put a lot of odd constraints on brewing at Fort Smith State.
Well,
it's gotten better, but
I mean, they're all antiquated laws. Yeah. I mean, even I think people at TABC would tell you that they don't make sense. They're just there to enforce them.
Yeah, like the Crowler situation.
Yeah, I mean, that's just, it was like they're just in. I mean, if you look at the Crowler law, like, or how they interpret it, you go, all right, I can see what you mean. It's stupid.
Yeah,
but I see what you mean.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the same thing with, like, brew pub versus production brewery. You're like, yeah, okay, I can see how it was written,
mm-hmm.
but it's dumb. Like, there's no, but I would argue that you couldn't find anybody in the state that would be like, oh, no, it makes complete sense. What are you talking about? Yeah, it's all, I mean, it's all stupid.
So where do you, speaking of all this, I mean, where do you see yourself in 5-10 years from now? Where do you want to be?
Taking over the world. no, actually, so it's funny, it's kind of a half joke, half serious. We just, when we were in Brussels, is because we were setting up European distribution. So
awesome.
We're going to be contract brewing in Europe. We haven't signed anything, so it's not super finalized, but should be by the end of this year having at least, what is it, like 7,000 barrels like released into
awesome.
France. And then the following year, they're going to do about 12 to 13,000 barrels. So like when we... Yeah, I mean, hey, it's one of those things where, like, the rumors have already started, so I'd rather just go ahead and sum it up and just say, like, you know, we're not really we don't want to take anything away from our current market.
Yeah.
And so the deal would had to be right and had to be perfect for us to do it.
Mm-hmm.
They came to us.
Yeah.
I mean, it wasn't like we were seeking out this whole thing, but they actually came to us, and it ended up being a really great deal for us. So.
And that would be a landmark for a Texas brewery, right?
Yeah.
For a craft brewer.
Well, for a craft brewery. I mean, Jester King's over in, like, Amsterdam.
Are they?
And
okay.
All those places.
There's Stone.
Yeah, Stone.
Yeah, well, I know what Stone. I was.
Yeah, but no, Jester King's kind of like led that charge. I think they're going into Japan now and stuff.
Okay.
But they're also kind of like that niche, like, brewery where, like, they, you know, like, they're weird.
Yeah.
Weird.
Yeah. But I think from when we were over there in Brussels, France, looking around, there just wasn't a lot of American beer you saw on the shelves. So the weird thing would be we'd be over here maybe doing, you know, max 5,000 barrels over the next year. And over there we'd be doing, competing with a Stone or BrewDog in those areas, which would be pretty strange. But it kind of a first for, definitely a first for a Texas brewery, but even on a U.S. stage.
Yeah, that's really cool.
The kind of the deal that's put together is completely different than anything that's been done.
It's really awesome. It's a new frontier over there. It's an untapped market in a lot of ways, which is why Stone opened Berlin.
Yeah, I mean, we talked to the people at Cantillon, and like only 3% of the people that go to Cantillon are from Belgium.
Hmm.
So, I mean, 60% is American, 20% is Canadian. The rest is like other European countries. So, I mean, there's an untapped market. Like he was saying, it's like you look at the shelves there and you're like, cool, Heineken.
Yeah.
Great. What else we got?
Well, and I think for the most part, like a lot of their beers or their breweries are so stuck in tradition and how this beer was made like 60 or hundreds of years ago. And, you know, I think Americans get to be a little bit more progressive with the recipes we do. We get to, you know, push the limit a little bit more and, they really eat that up now. So,
yeah, it's funny. We have a friend that lives in Sweden, and he'll go over to Denmark, and he'll talk about, oh, it's easy to find when Prairie Bomb was rare. They're fully stocked, or KBS, Poundersen's pallets of that over.
Yeah.
And it's like any American brewers that are making a footprint over there are trying to put their best foot forward for sure.
Oh, for sure. And one thing that I want to say, though, is that so that way it's cleared up, is that this allows us to, like, double down here. Mm-hmm. It's one of those things where, like, we – like, the way the deal is being set up is that it really doesn't cost us anything, but we benefit 100% from it. So it'll allow us to expand, like, this brewery and anything else. Yeah. So it's not one of those things where we're like, oh, cool, we're going to be huge. We're going to be like David Hasselhoff. We're just going to – no, like, we're not going to be huge in Germany. We want to be big here, too, if right. we can. But we want to have that kind of growth that we need and have to have here to sustain that. So it's just one of the things where, like, I don't want anybody to be like, oh, they're going to Europe and yeah. they're just going to forget about us. It's like, if we were going to do that, like, we would have already moved. So and we jokingly thought about that when we were there. We were like, oh, man, they're going to make more beer than we do in America. Why don't we just move here and just live off of this? We don't have to brew anything. We can just be, like, the faces. Like, not, except for nobody I don't think wants to see my face. Maybe Tommy and Kendra. But
so how's it going to work? Do you I assume they're going, whoever you're working mm-hmm. with, they're going to hire the full staff and mm-hmm. the brewers. And
so it's just contract brewery. We use a brewery that's already established. Okay. And they just have extra barrelage that they need, you know, produced, and, you know, cans get paid for, grain gets paid for.
Essentially a franchise.
Yeah.
We're essentially selling off our licensing there, and then we collect royalties.
So you send them your recipes, and you have mm-hmm. a chemist alter the water to match yep. the Texas water?
Well, no, we let them, what we do here is.
Noble Rey Export.
Yeah, we call it Noble Rey Export.
And, okay. we're tweaking some of the recipes to fit the European market a little bit better, mm-hmm. you know, so it'll. We're changing it slightly to, you know, fit them. Right. So
your Saxon Canoe will probably do really well over there.
Yeah, so that's actually the beer they really wanted, was okay. Saxon and Canoe. But the thing is that we're actually raising the ABV and the IBUs because to fit more with the European mm-hmm. market. So in our tap room, we're actually going to do, like, beers called, like, Noble Rey Exports. And so you'll be able to drink the same beers that we make there here.
Right.
We're just going to make them on that 3.5 barrel system. So it's just... Yeah. So it's another interesting thing that we're doing. But, no, one of the things that we do here is we try to make sure it's what Michael Petacolis does, too. It's the, you know, use the water from where you are.
Mm-hmm.
Don't really change the water too much. I mean, you don't want to have, like, you know, a bunch of crap floating in it.
Right.
So you clean it up the best you can, but you don't do too much of the water where it makes the beer taste different. I mean, that's why German beers are so good. That's why, you know, like, British beers are so good, is that you're tasting the water from there.
The biggest thing I do with our water is balance the pH. That's
right.
That's really the most important part, and that's really all I mess with.
Yeah.
And our beers have been fine. I like the way they come out with the water we have. I wouldn't want to change it. Mm-hmm. Like, I've been offered to do full water tests for free from different companies or different homebrewers, you know, or even myself, but I didn't even wanted to look at it because I just wanted to. I know I'll start messing with it if I see the numbers. I'll start being like, oh, we should do this, we should. But
yeah,
I like the way our beer stays with the water.
Yeah.
I like all the Dallas beers. I think we have pretty good. It's just keeping the pH down is the biggest part of it.
I know, like Kona, I think they're getting sued because they say they're brewed in Hawaii, but they have that brewery, that contract brewery up in Portland. Or they open a new one, and they alter the water to match the water in Hawaii. And so I found that really interesting because they want to keep it obviously tasting the same, and now they're getting sued as a result of claiming their Hawaiian brewery.
Oh, I mean, it's like the Tito's thing. It's not made in Austin anymore, but they're like – so they just call it, like, I think it's like Texas vodka.
Yeah.
They can't say, like, made in Texas anymore,
mm-hmm.
which I get that. I mean, I don't think we ever say made in Texas. Like, our cans say, like, brewed at this, but we put the facility where it's at.
Right.
So. In Europe, it'll say, like, brewed at this brewery. It won't say, like, brewed in America. No, we brewed it here, you know, but it's our styles.
So they indicated that outside of lagers that they think the European market is open to some of the more radical American styles?
Yeah. The second beer that we're doing there is the Vertigo.
Okay.
So they were excited about that one. They were down for the our Texas Red Ale off the leash and then Steampunk. And then they were interested in any future ideas that we're doing. We talked to them about sours, but I think one of the breweries that we were talking to, it's like, that's too big of a system to do like any kind of sour. And if it f***s it up there, then it's like, I don't want to have anything to do with like, oops, our beer messed up your system. Sorry.
All right. Well, that's a lot of future plans. That's awesome. Congratulations on
that. Well, thank
you. So let's get the lightning round. I'll let you guys get back to your job here.
Okay.
So I want to know from each of you, what was your first beer and then what was your first craft beer? I think we know with you, your first beer.
We're just going to go down the road.
Okay, first beer?
Yeah, first beer of any type.
I was probably like Coors Light or something in college. It wasn't great, but I think the first beer that sticks out to me when I really started getting into craft beer was Zombie Dust, Three Floyds. Nice. Love
that's
that.
That's a good first one to have.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yep. So, yeah, no, that works. So, actually, my first beer, there's actually photograph proof of when I had my first beer. I was two. It was a Coors Light. Actually, it was Coors Banquet. Which I still drink, like, even now. I'll still drink a Coors Banquet or every once in a while. It's not like I'm going to seek it out, but if it's available, sure, why not?
Yeah. Hey, I drink Miller Lite on occasion. I can't say anything.
Yeah, I mean, you're at, like, the baseball game right. or something. You can't make it to the craft beer section. Yeah. It doesn't a pinch. But then my first craft beer that I really enjoyed, other than the one I had at 13, man, I'm trying to remember. Stone, it was Arrogant Bastard. I was 18. My dad, he was a pilot, and he was coming back from San Diego. He was also in the Navy, and so he was stationed out there. And he brought back, like, a bomber of Arrogant Bastard, and it was just kind of things. I was like, oh, my God, there's breweries out there making, like, the beers that I enjoy. Like, why hasn't this happened sooner? And then it was, like, a couple years later, Rar opened up. So
I feel like Stone was a crossover for a lot of people around our age.
Yeah, oh, for sure. For sure.
Yeah, so my first just beer was Bud Light. That's what my dad drank. And then my first craft beer, I believe, was 60 Minute IPA.
That's a good one.
Yeah, they kind of, I don't think I really liked it when I first had it. It was just such a change. Yeah. And then from there, I just fell in love with craft beer. And I kind of forced myself. I think I got given a six-pack or something, but I forced myself to drink them, and then I was like, oh, I kind of like this.
Yeah, converted your palate after a six-pack?
Yeah.
So out of all your beers that you make or have made, what's the beer you're most proud of that you made?
I should restate that. I did, because I wasn't in the mic, yeah. outside of your own, all the beers you have brewed or have now, what's your favorite beer that you made, the one you're most proud of?
I think Vertigo's probably the one I like to brew the most and like to drink the most right now. I have future plans to brew some recipes that I've brewed in the past that I can't wait to put out, you know, to production. But Vertigo is the one that has come the furthest way and I think is almost, you know, the most solid beer that we brew as far as what we really like.
I guess for me, it's steampunk, just because it's been my most consistent. That was the first beer that we ever brewed here. It was the first beer that I ever brewed as a home brewer with the intent to have as a actual production beer. Does it do as well as all the other beers? Probably not as much as I'd like it to. I mean, it's one of those things where, like, if you talk to any brewer or brewery personnel, the beer that they like the most isn't always going to be the beer that's, like, as widely accepted, though. But I'm still proud of it.
I think my favorite would be Bridesmaid's Tears. It's our seasonal strawberry rhubarb saison. I mean,
sour saison.
Yeah, it doesn't get much better than that, really. And it was our wedding beer, so I'm partial to that. So
I love your Krampus, by the way.
Yeah.
I want that to come back soon. So outside of your own brewery, what would you say your favorite brewery is and why, if you can tell why?
This is so. These are hard questions, guys. Come on. No, I need to think about this.
Next. So she's gonna pass. No, favorite brewery outside right now. So it literally changes with the wind. But since we just got back from Belgium, one of my favorite craft breweries is Brussels Beer Project. Mostly because they're, like, I don't know, they're doing stuff that we kind of want to do here, and they've been doing it since day one. Which they have, like, they use a contract brewery to do, like, their four or five core beers, and then their actual brewery, it's a playground. It's like, hey, what are we gonna make now? And nothing's the same. They just, the five beers, like, that they make core for year round, that's it, and everything else is new. Like, it's just, hey, we're making something different, that's it. Like, you're gonna get in a bottle, and they sell, like, bottles, like seven, like little tiny, like 375 milliliter bottles, and that's all you're gonna get. And they sell those, and it's like, And it's one of those things where, like, you can go in there 1 week and try something, come back the next week, and it's gone. Because it's like, it's a dream brewer's job, and it's a dream, like, brewery idea where you're like, man, new beer, like, almost every week? Awesome. Would that model sustain itself here? Not yet. Yeah. Like, I don't think it would. I mean, you'd have to be, like, a full-fledged brew pub where you had, like, the restaurant as, like, your backbone.
You kind of need to be, like, a... maybe in a neighborhood somewhere too, where people could just walk over or stop in,
or someplace like Portland,
like
Portland, Oregon, where it's like you're in downtown, you've got like a 10 barrel brew house, that's it,
kind of like what Brain Dead's doing essentially, but they distribute out, which is you know, that I mean, that'd be awesome for us. We could do that, but it's finding 30 barrels to sell out tops of every beer you. Random beer you put out is, is very difficult.
That's kind of what we're trying to do with the three barrel system that we got. It's, you know, we're just going to come with some random crazy beers, and we're trying to do like 2 to 4 new beers every month. Some of them will package, some of them will just be draft only. Some things that we'll bring back, like, you know, like Little Man's Complex is a beer that we did first year and then never did again. We might bring that back, just tweak it up a little bit, just because, you know, it is what it is. So,
Tommy, what's your favorite brewery outside of Noble Rey?
I think my favorite brewery's got to be BrewDog. Even over all the controversy or whatever, I think what they've done.
The United Airlines and Brewery.
Yeah. But they're, I mean, going from them, that's primarily the beer I drank when I lived in the UK, because they're always putting out something crazy over there. And just I love the industry of brewing, besides just brewing, and watching what they've done, and you know, it's going from them and then coming over and working for Deep Ellum was like great, because it was almost going into a little brew dog just the mindset and the promotion of your beers and the fun, you know. I'm sure it sucks to work there with how much beer they're pushing out, but from the outside looking in, it seems like such a fun brewery, such a fun place. They're always doing exciting things.
Oh, so it's like
kind of. We're in the starting stages of being like that, but just of how dramatically they grew and made the craft beer scene in the UK is built around BrewDog. Yeah. They started everything over there, and watching that, and then
between them and McKellar, it's
McKellar was all right when I was over there. I mean, I loved them, but A lot of Brits don't give a shit about any craft beer, really. Still don't.
The Danes and Swedes love them. I mean, those McKellar bars. And
yeah.
But I think I've loved everything just about McKellar's done.
Yeah, yeah, they're incredible. But BrewDog, just the business and the guys who run it and the way they put their brand out there is something I like to see. It's something we're trying to do. It's something Deep Ellum's definitely done.
So maybe someday you'll have a Noble Rey Hotel?
Yeah,
in Cleveland.
I would hope. Yeah. That'd be insane.
No, I'm not working on that at all.
You can't give away all the future plans.
Yeah.
You want my wish list? Is it Santa Claus time?
So, Kindra, did you figure out?
I think I came up with an answer. I've actually never been to Three Floyds. I'd love to go, but New Glarus, I think, does some quality beers. I love drinking all their beers. But I think to stay local, I think my favorite brewery to visit and spend time at is probably Jester King, because it's so beautiful there. I love their artwork. I love their vibe. And
you're such an awesome hipster.
I'm trying not to be, but I think their whole farmhouse vibe that they've got going on is kind of a dream brewery for us. So
I do wish they'd have better representation here at the festivals. They seem to like,
they
should always show up with just boxes of bottles and someone who doesn't know anything about the beer.
Yeah.
Like, you can ask the questions, those reps don't know anything.
They did more this year at Big Texas than they've done in a while.
They did, but it just seems like every other festival, it's because we don't get their best stuff here.
Right.
And we get, I mean, every once in a while we'll get something, you know, random and good, but most of the time it's like the stuff we've seen, Mad Meg, Witcher's Rye or whatever it is, like the same 3 or 4 beers. And so I'm not that excited about just getting here. I've never been to the campus, but I just, because such poor representation here in Dallas, which I find just weird because we're so close.
I think they have that, like, we don't care, laid back attitude, which is not me. I like to be in your face. I like to be like.
But then they're expanding into Europe, conversely, and they're ambitious in a lot of the markets.
When we went to the Belgium, pretty much everyone's they have the best sours. Mm-hmm. Every bar we went to had the best sours in the world on. Mm-hmm. And everyone's just, y'all got Jester King, blah, blah. And I was like, do you not realize what you have here?
But yeah.
I mean, they brew really good beer. Yeah. They do something different than anyone else here does. I just almost wish they would be, like, louder about it.
Yeah.
And that's just from a personal, I like breweries to be loud. I like beer to be loud.
Well, it's definitely true of BrewDog. They're loud and in your face.
Yeah. That's me. Completely. So that's the thing I have against Jester King.
Yeah.
I like about 60% of the beers they put out. Mm. And when they hit it, they nail it. It's great. It's fantastic.
He generally likes 10% of everybody's.
They're so wild ass, though. You never know what they're going to do.
Yeah.
So did you guys bring back any Cantillon to consume here at home?
No.
No, you didn't.
No, we didn't buy the suitcase that they sell there. Tommy and I lugged like an entire 12 case suitcase through, what was it, 2 miles from from Cantillon to our hotel.
Oh, wow.
And then on a train to Amsterdam and then through an airport. And so we did that.
I actually got lost and then I was freaking out at my house. I had 20 bottles that I'd fix in this case and got home and it was gone. And next day, they showed up. They're like, we're on the way to your house. We got your – and Ron, they got there. I just ran out, opened it, and make sure everything was all right.
That is the scariest thing about, traveling, especially on airplanes with beer, is, oh, my God, if it breaks in flight.
Right.
Not only the fact it's going to ruin everything. It's I took the time to wrap this thing and make sure it was going to be safe.
Funny thing is the biggest issues that I've ever had with traveling with beer is, cans because the pressure, it just gives it something to go. Glass bottles, they generally hold up.
Yeah.
So you're as long as that guy throwing my bag on the plane didn't, launch it, I think I'm good.
Yeah.
But, Tommy's going to get back.
Thanks, Tommy.
It's one of those things where you're please don't launch it. Please don't launch it. You're looking out the window, is that my bag? Did he just throw that? Damn it.
All right. Well, last question. Sure. So IPA stout or something else as far as favorite style goes?
Something else.
What's that something else?
Something else. I mean, right now it's just kind of whatever Tommy out of his brain. Because seriously, he's on a rush. That dude is just he's coming up with weird styles. Or traditional styles just with a strange twist to it.
Right.
And I'm just yes. Every time I'm he's hey, can we do this? I'm don't even ask me anymore, man. Just do whatever you want to do. As long as it doesn't cost $1 million, I'm in.
Yeah.
So something else.
I'd say something else, and my something else would be, I usually lean more towards the Belgian styles and the sours. Hmm. I'm really into those right now, although this time last year I was really into IPAs. So my palate's really progressing here. So ask me next year what I'm going to be all about. So, that's my quick answer.
Other immediate future plans, other than Europe, the grand European plans, anything you want to talk about or
announce? We're trying, since we got the hot liquor tank issue, we're trying to get caught up and distribute into Houston with plans to go into Austin and San Antonio by the end of the year.
San Antonio needs it.
Trust me, we know. We got friends there. There's one bar in San Antonio that actually carries us. And they'll drive up here to get it.
Yeah.
So that's kind of one of the cool things. So, we're working on those.
Yeah, we talked to Ranger Creek, and we talked about the dearth of craft beer there.
I would love to get some of their barrels and stuff, too. Yeah. So.
Seems really strange for a metro area that large.
Does. It's one of those things where, I know there's a couple breweries coming online. Actually, one of our grain suppliers is from San Antonio, and they've really been trying to push more local guys and be hey, you should open a brewery. One of the jokes is that if we open up a second location, we're just going to open up another location, just put it in San Antonio, just because there's not a whole lot of breweries there. Mm-hmm. I mean, you got Freetail. I'm drawing a blank, but I know there's three other
Ranger
ones.
Ranger Creek, Freetail.
Yeah. Well, is Ranger Creek really in San Antonio?
Yeah.
Is it
in
San Antonio?
They're on,
I thought that was on a small town outside, but
no, they're in San Antonio proper.
Okay.
But there's Freetail.
Well, sorry, Ranger Creek.
Ranger Creek and someone else, I'm drawing a blank. But, yeah, there's, like, a total of three or four.
Well, because there's one that does – they do, like, the official beer for, like, the San Antonio Spurs or something like that. Because that's the only thing in San Antonio.
Right.
Sorry, I had to look at the camera and say that. It's kind of like how the Houston Rockets are the only thing in Houston.
I know Freetail.
Worth anything.
We went to see Will and Nelson and whatever stadium we were at, which is where the Spurs play. And Freetail had a big representation there. So
no, that's cool.
Yeah.
So I do respect that then. If like San Antonio is willing to do that, like wherever the Spurs play, it's like, hey, we're going to invest in like San Antonio stuff.
Yeah.
I wish that the Mavericks would do the same thing.
Right.
So.
All right. Well, Tommy, you're back suddenly. So I'll ask you the question, and then we'll let you guys go. Favorite style, IPA, stout, something else?
Style that I like the most. Actually, the beer style I like the most is probably Saison.
Something else.
I do like IPAs done well. The thing I have against IPAs is it seems like the style that's popular changes so often that you constantly, for me as a brewer, it makes it annoying. There's a, because you always want to be on market, you always want to be on trend. Mm-hmm. So you're constantly, I think a craft brewery should, if I want to change Vertigo, I should be able to change it. It's not always going to taste the way it does right now. I want to stay on trend.
If you want to be on trend, you should have a hazy Northeast IPA now.
We're coming out with one.
What's that called, Tommy?
So we have a tactical combat firefighter.
Yeah.
Which it can be from when I was I worked for the Department of Defense when I got out of the military as a firefighter for different companies, contract companies. in Afghanistan, Iraq, in other countries. Mm-hmm. And so the big joke was when someone would come from the civilian side, they would always call themselves a tactical combat firefighter, and we call them Rambo, or we had different like nicknames for them. So we're coming out with an IPA called Tactical Combat Firefighter, which one version of it will be a hazy Northeast style. We're using Saccharomyces. It's gonna be tropical. It's gonna be on trend. Yeah. And then we can always that's one beer that will be flexible, being able to change throughout the courses of every year when IPAs have to be different or they don't sell.
Yeah.
So or they're not relevant anymore if you don't change it up. So I do like a good IPA, but probably favorite beer style would be a Saison.
All right. Well, Kendra, Chris, Tommy, thanks for your time. Spent a lot of time with us today. I think this is our longest interview to date, but it was good. It was a great conversation. Yeah, you set a new record.
Whoa. Good thing the mic's over here.
Thanks for your time. Congratulations on all the success. And keep making awesome artwork and get some nachos.
Yeah. Hey, he's the food guy, too.
Yeah.
Put the orders in.
Thanks, guys.